Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Fundamentals of Enterprise Risk Management. How top companies assess risk, manage exposures, and seize opportunities. Written by John J. Hampton. Read by Stephen Menasche. Introduction. Risk quote. Keep your friends close and your enemies closer. Sun Tzu, Chinese general and military strategist around 400 BCE. Risk quote. This was my father's study. He taught me a lot of things in this room. He taught me to keep my friends close and my enemies closer. Michael Corleone in The Godfather, 1976. Welcome to the world of Enterprise Risk Management, ERM, one of the most popular and misunderstood of today's important business topics. It is not very complex. It is not very expensive. It does add value. We just have to get it right. Until recently, business has been getting it wrong. The first edition of this book carried us into the heart of risk management. It was mostly about how to do a better job of risk identification. If we define the problem correctly, we reduce surprises, not eliminate them, mind you, but get many of them under control. This book continues our journey with massive updates. Risk management has changed dramatically since the 2008 financial crisis. Recent developments in technology and communications demand new approaches to manage risk and seize opportunity. They still build on the basic structure of ERM. Upside of risk. Most people discuss risk as the possibility of loss. This is totally insufficient because risk has an upside. A lost opportunity is just as much a financial loss as is damage to people and property. This is a key insight. Ask Sun Tzu or Michael Corleone. Alignment with the business model. Within a framework for achieving goals, a single manager can supervise directly only a limited span of subordinates. Similarly, one person can oversee a limited number of risks. ERM encourages us to create hierarchy of risk categories aligned with the business model. Risk owners. A single person should be responsible for every category of risk. When questions arise, we go directly to the risk owner. We will see an exception to this guideline in Part 3, where we address risks with no single risk owner. Central risk function. Although risks cannot be managed centrally, a central risk function acknowledges that some risks cross units and responsibilities. The function influences risk decisions by scanning for changing conditions from a central vantage point and sharing findings. This book argues that a central risk function should not itself have responsibility for management decisions. Risk goes with the risk owners. High-tech electronic platform, HTEP. ERM encourages the use of new technologies. This book describes a cutting-edge technology and a revolutionary way to use it. The results are amazing. The book is organized in four parts. Part 1. Essentials of Enterprise Risk Management. What is ERM? What is not ERM? What are its key components? Why do we need a central risk function, risk identification, a high-tech platform? We address risk management successes and failures and cover lessons learned since the original publication of this book. Part 2. Risk Management Technology. This is big. In the first edition, we examined visualized risk relationships and backed up the view with supporting detail. You will not believe the developments since 2008. Building on the success of Riskonnect, we describe the high-tech electronic platform, HTEP, that serves so many companies today. If we thought technology was big 6 years ago, and it was, it is amazing today. Part 3. Risks without risk owners. Some risks depend on collaboration, crossing as they do the silos of organizations. With a central risk function and modern technology, we update strategic risk, subculture risk, leadership risk, and life cycle risk. We examine how weak management practices endanger success and how the absence of a clear and achievable vision can be destructive. Included are incisive stories about IBM, Microsoft, and Apple, and their rise, decline, and efforts to rebound. And Part 4. Special topics. Here, we fill in the picture of risk management. Cyber risk management deserves a chapter of its own. The importance of collaboration is demonstrated with examples. The struggles of Cerberus, JPMorgan, and Lehman are documented. Three chapters build our understanding of modern risk managers. Our journey covers a mixture of concepts, tools, and stories that add richness and depth to managing enterprise risk. Modern risk management is both popular and misunderstood, but as we will see, it is not overly complex, nor is it expensive. It does add value. We just have to get it right. Is risk management a science, an art, a mystery, or is it plain old common sense? In the following pages, we update answers to these questions. Part 1. Essentials of Enterprise Risk Management. Here, we tell the story of why organizations should create modern risk management programs. Risks are related. One risk affects others as they cross the often artificial walls of day-to-day operations. People can be too close to risk or just too busy to recognize impending critical problems. We start with the features of modern risk management, a discipline that morphed from a narrow insurance-buying role. Stories and examples help us grasp hazard risk management as a foundation for ERM. What is modern risk management? What does it mean for an organization? What are the contributions it makes to our understanding of risk? Then we take a detour. Two challenges arose in 2007 and 2008 that seemed to undermine ERM. We examine Nassim Taleb's concept of the black swan and what it means for risk management. We follow up the 2008 financial crisis with the lessons we should have learned. We finish with the implementation of an ERM program. How can it be done? How should it be done? What resistance can we expect? Chapter 1. Hazard and Enterprise Risk Management. Risk quote. More than at any other time in history, mankind faces a crossroads. One path leads to despair and utter hopelessness, the other to total extinction. Let us pray that we have the wisdom to choose correctly. Woody Allen, movie producer. Risk quote. Better to remain silent and be thought a fool than to speak out and remove all doubt. Abraham Lincoln, U.S. President. Hurricane Andrew. In 1992, Hurricane Andrew caused significant losses to Allstate, State Farm, and other insurance companies because Florida's insurance law did not handle flood and wind damage properly. If wind took off the roof before a storm surge destroyed a house, how much would separate wind and water policies pay to reimburse the damage? After cleaning up the mess, insurance companies worked with the Florida State Insurance Department to apportion loss from a combination of water and wind. In 2004 and 2005, Hurricanes Francis, Charlie, Ivan, Katrina, and Rita damaged property in Florida. As a result of the new laws, insurers saved money and homeowners received prompt and efficient claims processing. The change made after Hurricane Andrew is effective risk management. Still, it had a flaw. The insurance companies operated in isolated units that did not share risk information. They did not seek changes in the laws in Georgia, Mississippi, Louisiana, or Texas. The results were unnecessary complications resolving losses in 2005 when hurricanes damaged property in those states. A second Hurricane Andrew story reveals another flaw in sharing data. It involves the role of an actuary, a mathematician who determines the rate charged for insurance coverage. Actuaries work with historical data and make estimates of the frequency and severity of loss. In 1992, the data for Florida hurricanes was taken from the Okeechobee hurricane in 1928. It killed 2,500 people in South Florida when a storm surge breached the dike surrounding Lake Okeechobee. It also did serious wind damage to houses. In the 1920s, houses had been built with masonry walls and clay tile roofs. Both withstood wind damage very well. Still, 5% of roofs were lifted from their connections to homes. This was the damage level used in actuarial projections of property damage in the 1980s. The problem was that houses built in Florida in the 1980s had shingled roofs connected to the walls with nails or staples. A person visiting Miami in the months after the storm could drive on an overpass and see subdivisions where all the homes were covered with blue tarpaulins. Every single roof had been removed by the storm. The actuarial data failed to provide sufficient funds to pay the claims. It is not a surprise that 11 insurance companies were forced into bankruptcy. Definitions of risk. When someone tells us to take a risk or not to take a risk, what is the message? In most cases, risk has one of three meanings. 1. Possibility of loss or injury. This is the most common. We have something to lose, and we might lose it through an accident or misfortune. 2. Potential for a negative impact. This is generic. Something could go wrong. What could go wrong? We might face a decline in the value of a brand, or competitors might penetrate our markets. The negative impact may be vague and unknown. And 3. Likelihood of an undesirable event. This moves us into the world of quantitative analysis. We see a risk on the horizon. What is the likelihood that it will materialize? What will be the impact if it occurs? Can we quantify the damage? What will be our best case if it occurs? Our worst case? Hazard risk. This includes exposures that cause loss without the possibility of gain. A company may suffer physical damage to assets, as when fire destroys a building. Physical injury may occur when accidents, injuries, or disease strike employees or customers. Lawsuits can be the outcome of contractual or liability claims. Hazard risk can be broader than the direct damage it causes. An explosion at a refinery requires repair and renovation directly. Indirectly, the waiting period until the refinery is repaired causes an immediate loss of sales and may cause future business and financial losses. Insurable risk. An insurable risk is a form of hazard that meets specific criteria. 1. Definite loss. We can identify the cause, time, place, and extent of damage. 2. Monetary decline. If an exposure has no financial impact, it is not an insurable risk. And 3. Contingent loss. The exposure must be fortuitous, covering only losses not certain to happen. Side note: Hartford steam boiler. The development of new tools to manage hazard losses was accelerated by a single innovative company. It was the Hartford Steam Boiler Inspection and Insurance Company, HSB, founded in 1866 in Connecticut. Prior to the 1850s, small companies conducted most manufacturing in the United States using small plants in rural areas. Water power was the source of power. The number of factories with steam boilers and engines grew, and so did industrial hazards. Disastrous boiler explosions caused the loss of life and property. Hartford's steam boiler became an inspection company first and an insurance company second. It specified rigorous requirements for shutting down boilers to allow preventive maintenance and repair. If a manufacturer failed to comply with the inspection timetable and recommended repairs, the insurance would be voided. The result was a massive decline in boiler explosions and a new awareness of the importance of loss control. Risk management trumped insurance. Traditional risk management. Traditional risk management covers hazards and programs to avoid, mitigate, or transfer them. The major developments. 1. 1940s to the 1960s. Risk management began as a formal process in North America after World War II and then expanded around the world. Before the 1940s, organizations had buyers of insurance who focused almost exclusively on risk transfer. And 2. 1970s to the present. Risk management expanded into loss control, safety, and other strategies to avoid, reduce, or transfer risk. In addition to buying insurance, risk managers were expected to reduce losses. Insurance became a subset of risk management. Traditional risk management focused on four areas. 1. Insurable risk. Risk managers identified exposures, assessed them, chose strategies to cover their impacts, and implemented a risk management program. This process set up both preventive and crisis risk management. 2. Internal control. Companies have processes to provide reasonable assurance that policies are being followed. Elaborate systems became common, particularly in industries highly regulated by government agencies. 3. Internal audit. Internal auditors pursue assurance that internal controls are working. They focus on operating activities, the consistency of procedures, and compliance with directives. And 4. Regulatory compliance. This seeks to ensure conformity with official requirements imposed by statutes, public agencies, or the courts. Examples involve plant safety, environment standards, reliable financial reporting, and compliance with social and economic mandates. Traditional risk management identified four sources of hazard risk. 1. Physical risk. Situations where the real world creates danger. Fire, earthquake, driving vehicles on crowded streets, and flying in hot air balloons are examples. 2. Moral hazard. Arises from a lack of honesty or integrity. Examples are fraud, theft, tax evasion, and the sale of defective products. 3. Behavioral hazard. Derives from carelessness, as when people do not exercise a proper degree of caution driving a car, using a forklift in a factory, or cleaning a boiler. And 4. Legal hazard. Anybody can be sued, and thus frivolous and numerous lawsuits are by themselves sources of hazard risk. Side note: Global Petroleum. A global petroleum company refined products tanker was rounding the coast of Scotland at the height of the summer vacation season. It ran aground in a storm on rocks close to a small resort town with 300 year-round residents and one 40-room hotel. Within 24 hours, a crisis team arrived to contain the oil spill, which was growing by the hour. The team consisted of a team leader, a systems specialist, a finance specialist, a petroleum engineer, a logistics specialist, and a public relations manager. Within 12 to 36 hours after the spill, tugs from London arrived with oil containment equipment. They were joined by 150 workers who would work 12 hours on and 12 hours off for 3 to 4 weeks to clean up the spill. The crisis team leader saw an immediate problem. Few local residents were willing to provide sleeping accommodations for workers. The hotel was booked solid with summer vacationers that the owner would not displace. The nearest town with hotels was 120 kilometers, 75 miles, from the spill. Searching for a solution, the team leader considered alternatives to solve the housing problem. He could negotiate with the hotel or homeowners, bring in tents or a small cruise ship, or bus workers to and from hotels in the distant town. What should he do? In the sense of modern risk management, the company gave full authority to the team leader to mitigate risks without seeking permission. He bought the hotel and displaced the guests. Weeks later, he sold it back to the original owner at a loss that was much less than the likely cost of indecision or inaction. Lesson learned. What is the real lesson? Think about it. Do you have the authority to offer £5 million for a hotel? Is your organization set up with a risk management program that can transfer money on a moment's notice to a Scottish bank? This is modern risk management. Prepare for a loss. React to it with an effective mitigation strategy. Severity and frequency. Hazard risk is commonly measured on two scales. 1. Severity refers to the intensity or magnitude of a loss or damage. A medium-high or high-severity loss causes serious business disruption or damage to people, financial position, assets, or reputation. A medium-low or low-severity loss causes less damage. 2. Frequency refers to the likelihood of occurrence of a loss, damage, or missed opportunity. Some losses, like vehicle accidents, are frequent and predictable. Some potential losses are so remote that we cannot imagine how they could happen. Low frequency and low severity exposures are not of much concern. High frequency and high severity exposures can produce disastrous consequences. Side note. World Trade Center. Larry Silverstein acquired the lease to operate the New York City World Trade Center, WTC, 2 months before a terrorist attack destroyed the complex on September 11, 2001. Although the WTC had been damaged by a car bomb in its underground parking space in 1993, Mr. Silverstein did not foresee a high-severity exposure to the WTC. Thus, he insured the Twin Towers for $3.6 billion, half the replacement cost if both towers were lost in a single occurrence. Years of litigation followed the 2001 loss. Mr. Silverstein claimed that the two hijacked airliners were separate occurrences for insurance purposes, entitling him to collect twice on the policies. The problem was compounded by an insurance policy that had been discussed but not issued as of the date of the attack. Two policy forms were under consideration. One defined occurrence. Commonly, such a policy would cover any loss within a specified time period. The other policy form did not define occurrence at all. The result was that some insurers paid for one occurrence, some for two. Mr. Silverstein received $4.6 billion rather than the $7.2 billion full replacement cost for the property. Lesson learned. Frequency is not really an issue when dealing with the potential for catastrophic loss. To be protected, risk transfer should indemnify a total loss, even if the possibility of its occurring is remote. Enterprise risk. A broader definition than hazard risk became the norm for businesses, nonprofit organizations, and government agencies in the 1990s. Enterprise risk is the likelihood that actual results will not match expected results. Enterprise risk includes hazard risk as one of its major components. It adds operating, strategic, and financial risk to the focus. In this perspective, risk has two characteristics. One, variability. Expected results from operations or decisions may not match our sometimes elaborate forecasts. Why did we miss our forecast? What went wrong? The answer is probably nothing. The world is variable. 2. Upside of risk. When an enterprise engages in its activities, it accepts risk. Results may be better or worse than expected. Enterprise risk explicitly considers both possibilities. Levels of enterprise risk. From these concepts, we recognize some risks are serious and some are not. 1. Minor. This is a situation where a loss would hurt an operating unit but not be noticeable on financial statements. 2. Significant loss. This can cause a reduction of current year revenues or earnings that has a substantial impact on operations. 3. Critical or major loss. This seriously hampers a firm's ability to do business. An example is the collapse of a major operating unit or product line, followed by a substantial financial setback that could lead to bankruptcy. And 4. Catastrophic loss. This involves the destruction of a majority of assets, an unbearable financial loss, and an inability to continue operation. It produces a near-term, if not immediate, bankruptcy and dissolution of the enterprise. Enterprise risk accountability. To deal with differing impact of risks, we use a progression of risk events. They include incident, emergency, crisis, disaster, catastrophe, recovery, or failure. 1. Incident. An occurrence of seemingly minor importance that can lead to serious consequences. ERM monitors such events that normally arise in operational areas. 2. Emergency. A serious situation when an unexpected incident demands immediate action to avoid more damage. 3. Crisis. A time of intense difficulty or danger when an important decision must be made. The quality and speed of the decision determines the turning point for an improved or worse outcome. 4. Disaster. A point when the risk can threaten the survival of the organization. And 5. Catastrophe. The final stage of organizational failure to deal with a risk. The organization is destroyed because rarely can risk management efforts be effective at this level. Enterprise risk incorporates hazard risk, but also adds operational, strategic, and financial risk to its perspective. Operational risk. This is a failure in the management of internal processes, people, and systems. It reflects the possibility that an organization will not compete successfully. Exposures vary with the line of business, the nature of the entity, political and economic issues, and other factors. Exposures can erupt suddenly or develop over time. The company may fail to update a product or service. Technology may make current activities obsolete. Customer preferences may change. Strategic risk. A strategy may be seen as a high-level plan to achieve one or more goals under conditions of uncertainty. Strategies involve patterns of decisions to undertake activities, allocate resources, pursue behaviors, and achieve outcomes. Strategic risk arises from possible losses as a result of pursuing an unsuccessful business plan and making poor business decisions. It reflects the substandard execution of decisions, inadequate resource allocation, or a failure to respond to changes in the business environment. Side note: Daimler and Chrysler. Daimler AG is an example of a company that suffered a business risk loss. In 1998, Daimler exchanged stock worth $38 billion to merge with Chrysler Corporation. After investing billions of dollars in Chrysler over a 10-year period, Daimler sold the bulk of the firm to Cerebus for less than $8 billion. It is likely that Daimler used a thorough acquisition analysis that considered the possibility of such a debacle. Would it succeed because of the synergies and shared technology of the two companies? Would the differences in corporate cultures prove deadly? Would external changes in consumer preferences, the price of oil, or other factors make the merger untenable? As it turned out, the synergies did not materialize, and the clash of cultures proved to be disastrous. Daimler failed to merge the distinct German corporate culture with the proud but troubled executives and workers in Detroit. Is the failure of this merger a case of operational or strategic risk? Answer? Whatever the answer, operational and strategic failures can destroy the upside of risk. Financial risk. The last component of enterprise risk is financial risk, the possibility of a shortage of funds for operations. The problem can be caused by an inadequate initial capitalization, or it can result from cash flow problems in operations. Customers can fail to pay their bills, or creditors can tighten lending requirements. High interest costs or restrictions on borrowing may constrain expansion. The use of short-term debt to finance long-term assets may produce liquidity problems or leave insufficient cash to pay dividends. Side note: Amazon and Webvan. In the 1990s, two companies entered the online arena for consumer products. Amazon.com started operations in 1995, selling books via the internet, and then diversified to sell other products. Webvan was an online food business that accepted internet orders and delivered grocery products to customers. Amazon succeeded in its venture, becoming the largest online retailer in the world. Webvan ran out of money and filed for bankruptcy in 2001. What accounts for the difference between Amazon and Webvan? Both looked like promising investments in the new marketplace of the internet. A risk analysis would have shown key differences. 1. Operational risk. It should have been apparent that Webvan had serious problems in distribution. Amazon simply accepted orders and fulfilled them using an existing UPS distribution system. Webvan had to build its own system. 2. Strategic risk. Another factor was that Webvan was not aligned with its markets. It offered daytime delivery within a 30-minute window to customers who used the service because they were too busy to shop. They were not home in the daytime, so the food would spoil. Amazon could deliver its non-perishable products anytime and leave them on the doorstep. Financial risk. Both companies needed considerable capital, but the financial risk was much greater for Webvan. One part of the exposure was of its own making. Webvan signed a billion-dollar contract with Bechtel to build warehouses, purchased a fleet of delivery trucks, and spent a large sum of money on equipment. A second part was the difference in markets for Amazon and Webvan. The expensive delivery structure squeezed the profits from the grocery business. Webvan was doomed by a combination of a tight cash flow accompanied by capital inadequacy. Lesson learned. Risk management recognizes the difference among operational, strategic, and financial risks while recognizing that they can merge to produce either good or bad results. Conclusion. Traditional risk management has not fully morphed into a broader perspective. We continue the journey building on the solid foundation just described. Appendix 1. Russian Frozen Chicken. We can gain a more in-depth understanding of risk management by illustrating it for an international project. Expropriation risk. A company had a project to export frozen chicken by ocean-going vessels from Virginia and North Carolina to St. Petersburg, Russia. The company planned to load 60 to 80-pound boxes on pallets for the ocean voyage. A problem arose because the port of St. Petersburg had no shoreside refrigeration to allow the quick unloading of an expensive reefer vessel. The company would incur significant demurrage charges, extra costs resulting from a vessel delay, if the ship wasted time in port while it waited for containers or railroad cars. One option was to build a warehouse, but the risk manager identified an expropriation risk. She spotted an action involving the Hotel Europa in St. Petersburg, which was partly owned by European investors. In the mid-1990s, the hotel opened a foreign bank account to handle dollar transactions. Russian banking laws prohibited such accounts. When the government learned of the account, a government agency levied a heavy fine on the hotel, causing the foreigners to lose their entire investment. Effectively, the government confiscated the hotel. The risk manager knew she could obtain insurance from an agency of the U.S. government to reimburse the company for expropriation. At the same time, was it really an expropriation? Insurance did not seem to be the answer. Thus, the company considered buying an old and relatively inexpensive reefer vessel and using it for storage. It could build a refrigeration facility on a barge that could be moved if the situation became sticky. Alternatively, it could find a strong Russian partner with high-level government connections and allow the partner to accept the expropriation and storage exposure. The company found such a Russian partner. Lesson learned. Investigate all options for risk mitigation. Do not assume that the traditional insurance approach is the answer. Credit risk. So, good news. The company exporting frozen chicken to Russia had a partner. This was also the bad news because it created a credit risk. How would the U.S. company insure payment from the Russian partner? It was not realistic to demand payment in advance or to obtain a letter of credit to guarantee a future payment. The Russian partner was not able to pay for a cargo for 30 or so days after receiving it. To deal with the credit exposure, the parties agreed that the Russian partner would have to pay for one cargo before it could receive a subsequent cargo. How did this mitigate the exposure? The stream of profits from a series of cargoes was significantly larger than the funds from a default on payment for a single cargo. If the Russian partner did not deposit funds in a Western bank account by day 45 after receipt of a cargo, the ship carrying the next cargo would be diverted from Russia to a northern European port. Lesson learned. Give other parties, in this case the Russian partner, incentives to help your organization mitigate risk. Physical security risk. Once the Russian partner accepted the chicken in St. Petersburg, it shipped the chicken by railroad to Moscow, Yekaterinburg, and beyond. The cargo was placed in refrigerated containers that were locked and then loaded on flat rail cars. On the fifth journey, one of the containers was empty when it arrived in Moscow after the 3-day trip from St. Petersburg. At this point, the partner was facing a risk management problem. Two strategies were discussed. The first was to purchase insurance, an idea that was quickly eliminated. Who would insure a cargo with a high chance of loss? If a Russian insurance company agreed to provide coverage, the premiums would be prohibitively high. The second was door-to-door container placement. The railroad company would place containers on the flatbed rail cars so the doors could not be opened if the locks were broken. This was the chosen strategy. The story continues. Sometimes a risk mitigation solution does not actually solve the problem. Several journeys later, another container arrived empty. The partner realized that someone had a crane on a siding when the train stopped in the middle of the night. What else should be tried? The problem was finally solved by placing a boxcar on the back of the train. The car was fitted with heaters and cots. It carried guards with Kalashnikov weapons. Whenever the train stopped, guards stepped out to protect the containers. It was a simple but effective risk management strategy. Lesson learned. Stay with it until a risk management strategy works. Sometimes it takes a few tries to get it right. Upside of risk. The story of the guards on the train can be used to illustrate the upside of risk. The railroad security situation in Russia has improved significantly since the 1990s when the story unfolded. Prior to the improvement, a business opportunity arose. Once the cargo was being protected by armed guards, the Russian partner could offer insurance services to third parties to protect their cargoes as well as the chicken. The partner would incur small costs for the guards, but could be confident that the train would experience no losses. We do not know whether this opportunity was ever pursued. Chapter 2. Enterprise Risk Management. Risk quote. When you arrive at a fork in the road, take it. Yogi Berra, baseball player. Risk quote. The greatest glory in living lies not in never falling, but in rising every time we fall. Nelson Mandela, South African statesman. Enterprise Risk Management, ERM, emerged in the early 1990s as an extension of hazard risk management. It argues that an organization should manage enterprise risks in a single, comprehensive program. Risk versus uncertainty. Risk, something that we attach to a probability. In many cases, we can also calculate or estimate the financial cost or benefit. Uncertainty, something that can go wrong without an understanding of the consequences, likelihood, or cost or benefit. ERM raises issues about risk tolerance. How much risk are we willing to take? Which risks are we managing? Which risks are unbearable? Which are important? Which are unimportant? ERM became an organizational priority to identify and manage new exposures. ERM became a buzzword on the lips of CEOs, CFOs, members of boards of directors, and shareholders. Everybody understood that ERM was important. The question confronting organizations was how to get it right. By 2005, ERM had bogged down. Still, many risk observers pushed a strong ERM agenda. They recognized the logic of coordinating the management of risk. So, why did ERM implementation stall? The answer starts with several definitions of ERM. ERM defined. Enterprise risk management is a broad and complex concept that reaches into every major area of an organization. As such, it is not surprising that many definitions of ERM have been offered. These definitions fall into three categories. A strategic definition focuses on results, as ERM is expressed in terms of organizational objectives. A functional definition describes ERM in terms of activities that reduce risk. A process definition focuses on actions undertaken by managers to manage risk. A consensus definition might look something like this. Enterprise risk management is the process of identifying major risks that confront an organization, forecasting the significance of those risks in business processes, addressing the risks in systematic and coordinated plan, implementing the plan, and holding key individuals responsible for managing critical risks within the scope of their responsibilities. Side note: General Motors inventory. As organizations reach maturity, they can no longer depend on a rapidly growing market for goods and the continuation of the business that made them successful. They must seek new approaches to operations to increase their success in managing lifecycle risk. The following discussion involves Bo Anderson and his experience at General Motors Corporation. It provides a good story about modern risk management. In 2001, Bo Anderson became the top purchasing manager at GM. When he arrived, he realized that GM was spending $85 billion on car parts each year, purchased from 3,200 suppliers. He also learned that GM had separate engineering for almost every type of vehicle it produced. Vehicles did not share common parts. Seat frames were an example of a particularly interesting subculture feature. They were expensive, partly because GM had 26 different seat frames. Toyota only had two. A similar situation existed with V6 engines. Once again, GM had high costs because it had 12 V6 engines, whereas Toyota and Honda had two each. What about fuel pumps? GM had 12. Toyota and Nissan had two. Moving on, Bo Anderson addressed the rather simple topic of door hinges. He learned that they could be made out of three pieces instead of five. Making the change would save $100 million annually. He had a subculture response. Engineers and designers debated the change for more than 3 months. Then they reluctantly began a lengthy process of design and testing for the new door hinges. After studying the situation to be sure he understood it, Bo Anderson identified the design and purchasing problems and brought them to the attention of the engineers who worked in manufacturing. His arguments were carefully framed, but they were not well received. The different units did not support changes, arguing that a change in one component would have ripple effects throughout the entire line of automobiles. In the end, change came slowly over the period from 2001 to 2006. This is from Business Week, July 31st, 2006. Lessons learned. GM lacked a modern risk management approach to internal manufacturing. Production efficiency lagged badly while GM failed to make desperately needed changes to be competitive. GM needed ERM. One additional note, the GM situation is also a failure of leadership risk. This is covered in Chapter 14. The need for ERM. Why do we need to manage risk and pursue opportunity in a single, coordinated program? A few quick answers. 1. Survival. We want a better chance to identify, mitigate, avoid, and treat risks that could close us down. 2. Stability. We want reliable and predictable behaviors when creating, distributing, financing, and selling products and services. 3. Fiduciary responsibility. ERM helps the board and CEO meet their shareholder, employee, community, social, and ethical responsibilities. And 4. Ethics. ERM helps us build good relationships with other parties who expect us to observe legal and ethical behaviors in the conduct of our operations. This affects customers, employees, suppliers, creditors, and regulators. As we move past the definitions and need for ERM, some heavy hitters have joined the discussion. Towers Perrin on ERM. Towers, a professional services consulting firm, was an early advocate, believing that ERM is essential to achieve operating stability, build organizational resilience, and increase economic value. Towers Perrin developed a six-stage ERM roadmap to create a customized ERM program. Here are the six stages. Stage 1. Establish the current state of ERM capability. Stage 2. Contrast the current state to ERM best practices and produce a gap analysis highlighting areas that need improvement. Stage 3. define a target goal for ERM based on organizational strategy and risk profile. Stage 4. Prepare a formal action plan for implementation. Seek quick wins as well as longer-term ERM objectives. Stage 5. Implement the ERM vision using timelines, milestones, and assigned responsibilities. And Stage 6. Establish a formal monitoring process with continuous evaluation and reporting and follow-up initiatives. Moody's on ERM. Moody's was also an early advocate of ERM, using the tool to assess banks. In 2004, the company deployed Risk Management Assessments, RMA, to help it understand exposures facing non-financial companies. An RMA is built on four pillars. They are 1. Risk Governance. Are board members engaged in defining and reviewing the company's risk philosophy and appetite? Does the reporting structure, including budgeting and capital allocation, contain risk considerations? 2. Risk Management. Does the company have risk control processes with unit and operating level reporting lines and risk discipline? Does the company understand its risk appetite and have controls to set limits in portfolio diversification and business decision-making processes? Does the company use risk mitigation, risk control, and risk financing processes and technologies? 3. Risk analysis and quantification. Does the business quantify the level of risk that is acceptable? Does it have effective risk monitoring and reporting? And 4. Risk infrastructure and intelligence. Does the company have a risk infrastructure and supporting systems? Is risk intelligence developed with valid risk models and accurate and timely data? Standard & Poor's and ERM. Standard & Poor's uses ERM in rating financial securities for non-financial companies. It acknowledges management's overall capabilities, quality of strategies, and adaptability to changing conditions. It believes companies with superior ERM should have great stability of earnings and a high likelihood of repaying debt obligations. Side note: JetBlue Airways. Standard & Poor's proposed a unique approach to ERM in 2008. Instead of a specific formula or checklist, S&P believes managing enterprise risk depends largely on the quality of management. Still, even a high-quality management team can stumble if it does not use ERM. An example came on February 14, 2007, when New York City's Kennedy Airport was hit by a nasty ice storm. JetBlue Airways, the largest airline at Kennedy, used the airport as a hub of its entire network but was not prepared. Thousands of passengers were trapped in planes on runways for up to 8 hours. Aircraft ran out of food. Toilets overflowed. The airline canceled more than 1,000 flights and required 6 days to get the backlog cleared. Now, suppose JetBlue had had an ERM program that had identified the possibility of such an occurrence. Let us follow this through. Source of the risk. The risk stems from disruption of operations at peak flying time. Examples include ice storms, police action, and acts of terrorism. The upside would be a display of JetBlue's high level of customer service and enhanced reputation. The downside would be a negative public reaction and financial loss. Risk owners. This scenario is assigned to the Senior Vice President of Operations, who further assigns it to the Kennedy Airport Operations Center. Frequency. Ice storms hit New York City once every 3 winters. The likelihood is 1 chance in 3 that it will hit at a busy time. A peak travel disruption is thus likely to happen once every 9 years. Severity. The disruption could be a public relations boon if handled smoothly, and a customer relations nightmare if passengers were stranded on planes for long periods of time. It could be financially beneficial if good news attracts new customers or costly if the airline has to reimburse passengers for losses or time spent. Evaluation. A disruption is a major risk opportunity. Options. First, JetBlue could arrange to have buses available for an emergency. It could unload passengers stuck in planes sitting on the tarmac when all gates are full. Second, it could also provide additional personnel to solve problems, handle luggage, and mitigate discomfort. The company headquarters was a short distance from the airport. The company could train office staff on tasks needed during a crisis. Third, the company could institute rapid response capabilities for weather or other crises. Cost-benefit analysis. Any approach you use would be good risk management compared to leaving passengers stuck on planes. Epilogue. Before the incident, a Business Week magazine survey ranked JetBlue Airways fourth in the United States in customer satisfaction. After the incident, the magazine pulled the ranking from its March 5, 2007 edition and reported the failure in considerable detail. Prior to this single event, JetBlue had earned many honors for customer service. It was the top choice in a national airline quality rating 4 years in a row. It won a Reader's Choice Award 5 years in a row from Condé Nast Traveler. It always ranked high in J.D. Power's quality ratings. Then it stumbled. Lesson learned. An ERM program with constant scanning and sharing of risks might have avoided losses that exceeded $30 million. As former JetBlue customers purchase future tickets on other airlines, we will never know the true extent of the loss to JetBlue. Conclusion. The scope of ERM is broad. Therefore, it is important to simplify risk and to get it right in a complex world. We will continue to tell stories of how to do it right and wrong. Appendix 2. GM, Ford, and the Chrysler Bailout. In late 2008, General Motors, Ford, and Chrysler asked the federal government to help them survive a liquidity crisis resulting from the global financial meltdown. The following is a modern risk management analysis of the situation. The problems. The Big Three were struggling with a number of issues. 1. Lagging sales. GM, Ford, and Chrysler combined had less than half the market. Although GM remained number one with 20%, Toyota Motor Corp was a close number two in U.S. market share. 2. High costs. The companies had bloated salaried staff, probably 25% more than needed. Hourly labor costs were not competitive. 3. Legacy costs. The companies provided prohibitively costly retirement and healthcare benefits, ignored demographic trends on life expectancy, and failed to fund deficiencies in promised benefits. 4. Dealerships. All three companies had too many dealers. General Motors was in the most trouble. With approximately the same level of U.S. sales as Toyota, GM had 7,000 dealers. Toyota had 1,500. 5. Contractual commitments. Agreements with the United Auto Workers were highly punitive to the companies. One example was a program where 90% of wages and benefits were paid to laid-off employees. Another financial drain occurred when cities and towns financed facilities by issuing revenue bonds. If a company needed to close an underutilized facility, it could not do so without paying heavy penalties. And 6. Auto company management. The companies never seemed to have the ability or the courage to make desperately needed changes. Senior oligarchs were set in their ways, resisted suggestions for change, and stifled dissenting views and innovation. The solutions. The companies examined the strategies to fix the problems. 1. Lagging sales. The companies needed to become smaller. Too many competitors serve the U.S. market. Some brands, such as Chevrolet, Buick, Cadillac, Ford, Chrysler, and Jeep, had considerable loyalty. Even the quality was acceptable. The companies could focus on these brands, update features, and reduce the number of U.S. manufacturing plants. Sales could come into balance with desired vehicles. 2. High costs. No genius was needed here. Costs had to be cut. Companies could streamline salaried positions, cut back on hourly workers, and reduce other manufacturing and sales costs. 3. Legacy costs. No one wants to fail to deliver on prior promises. At the same time, contractual costs were not affordable. The companies had to modify or break contracts. 4. Dealerships. Many of the dealerships had to close. This would be horrible for local communities and loyal dealers who had become members of a family. No matter how we look at this issue, closures were inevitable. 5. Contractual commitments. If negotiations to change...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.